Good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Since most of you are already seated, please be seated. How are you all today? It's good to see all of you. This is like an annual family gathering, right? We don't have to wait until November for Thanksgiving. This is Thanksgiving homecoming. Amen. So every month, every year, in the month of August, we have this homecoming at Shekinah. So remember to keep your date every year in August, second week. All right? So you can plan your calendar throughout eternity. Right before the Antichrist comes. Then we won't meet here. We will be meeting in caves, in jungles, somewhere far out in somewhere. I'm glad to be here, and I look forward to this period of time each year. Although throughout the year, there are many conferences that we go to in many places around the world, and in many conferences that we personally organize, but this is one conference where I actually look forward to. One reason is to meet all the family, and another reason to meet with our fellow ministers like Brother Neville and our dear Pastor Sweet, who's very sweet. Don't you agree?
Yes.
In fact, too sweet, if not three sweet. You know, he and his lovely family who take very, very good, sweet care of all of us. Don't you agree?
Yes.
And another reason is, during this conference, God always reveals some special mysteries of Himself. Like when your president is elected, he makes this most important State of the Union address. So likewise, I feel that each year when we come here, it is something like that. God makes some very important statements, and you hear some marching orders, some understanding from heaven. What is heaven's plan? What God intends for His body to do, where we should walk, how we should do, how we should conduct ourselves. You know, one of the role of a New Testament or modern prophet, or I would rather say, use the word the last days prophet, is not simply to prophesy of things to come, or not just simply to have everybody stand in a row and then lay their hands and prophesy over each and every one of them, which is the most simplest thing to do. But one of the most important role of a last days prophet is to reveal the whole counsel of God. What is God intending at this period of time? What are the plans of God? The future plans. You know, if you read the Holy Bible, especially the prophetical books from Isaiah right up to Malachi, there is a two-pronged approach of prophecy. One is that which pertains to the nation of Israel, and another is to the events of the last days. Every one of those books, Isaiah right up to Malachi, and especially the books of Daniel right up to Malachi, they are all pointing towards the end times. and they speak of our days. There's always a two-pronged approach. So, certain things that are veiled in the prophecies, like for example, if you read the book of Daniel, the many, many visions and prophecies that he received, he was told, seal them up. When the prophet Daniel saw, he understood. He had the meaning, or he knew the meaning of those visions and the interpretations, but he was told, sealed it up. Let me give you another example. In Revelation chapter 10, when the apostle John saw this mighty huge angel who came and stood before him, he was so huge that the Bible says his head touched the clouds. You know, we always think angels to be of our normal height. Short is like me. You know, you may have seen two differences in this conference. Sometimes this pulpit is down there. Sometimes it's up here. Whenever it moves up here, it is meant for shorties. So that is a sign, the moving of the pulpit. You know, when that angel who stood so huge, whose head touched the clouds, when John stood beside the angel, he appeared as an ant, that small. And there are many more angels who are much taller than that. And when this angel of Revelation 10 stands beside those angels, he looks like a small ant. Then can you imagine what great things there are in heaven? You know, that's why the Apostle Paul writes, our eyes have not seen, our ears have not heard, neither has it entered into our mind what great things God has prepared for his people. Just 2 days ago, I was meditating the scriptures one morning. If you will turn your Bible with me to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4. These are just going to be preface to what I'm going to share with you, or what you're going to hear in this conference from all the speakers who are here. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and we will read from verses 3 onwards. But if our gospel be hidden, it is hidden to them that are lost, in whom the God of this age hath blinded the minds of them who believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, hath shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm sure you have read this scripture tons of times in your life. So have I. And the most popular interpretation of this scripture is, this pertains to those who are not saved. Because if you look at verse 3, it says, our gospel be hidden, is hidden to them that are lost. You know, all my years of being saved as a Christian in the year 1978 till now, whenever I read this scripture, that's how I understood. Being an evangelist, and that's how I understand until 2 days ago. 2 days ago, as I was meditating the scripture, the Lord, through his spirit, made it known to me there is another angle or another level of revelation of interpretation of the scripture, besides its natural meaning to as an evangelistic message to the lost, now this is another aspect of the interpretation. But if our gospel is hidden, be hidden, it is hidden to them that are lost. Lost to what? Lost to all the precious and valuable things of the things in heaven. And that refers to the Christians, in whom the God of this age hath blinded the minds, so that they cannot see and believe the deeper, larger things that are in heaven or the things that are to come. They cannot receive it, they cannot accept it, because the God of this age has blinded their eyes. That is why the established church or the learned theologians or the learned ministers or the learned believers oppose that this kind of new things. They are not new, they are age old. They are as old as the Bible is. They are opposing it, saying it's not of the Bible, or it is unscriptural, or it is unbiblical. Why do they say that? Because the God of this age has blinded their eyes from seeing beyond, from beyond what is normal. For example, when the Lord Jesus Christ walked this earth, he brought a new understanding to what has already been established for the last 3,000 years or 4,000 years. And the Pharisees and the Sadducees could not accept what the Lord Jesus was teaching. He said, you have been told, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. That's what you have heard, that's what you have been told from the law of Moses. But I say unto you, if anybody slaps you on your right cheek, turn your left. Could they receive it? They could not, because it is contrary, or it is something new that they have never understood or never known this past several thousands of years. And another established teaching was, you shall not work on the Sabbath day. But here comes the Lord Jesus, who is the Lord of the Sabbath, the God who created the Sabbath, and he went around doing good on the Sabbath day. He was eating on the Sabbath day. He was walking from point A to point B on the Sabbath day. He was healing the sick on the Sabbath day, which were contrary to all the established laws of the church. And he was heavily persecuted because he went contrary, or he swam against the tide of the present times. To the established church, whatever the Lord taught was heresy, because it was contrary to what they have known, contrary to what they are comfortable with, contrary to what they have been taught from the day they got saved in normal churches. Now comes something new. Scrolls coming down from heaven, chariots coming into a church, and you open your eyes, you don't see any chariot. You know, this afternoon, when our dear brother Dr. Bruce was sharing his message, I was waiting on God and preparing my message for this evening, and I just felt inspired, or a thought came to my mind, to log on to the website to see what he was going to share. And I happened to log on just 2 minutes before he said, I saw the Saint Zechariah in our midst, just 2 minutes before that. And when he asked everybody to stand up to receive that blessing or the anointing, I knelt down in my room. Because though we are far away, God is still near to bless us, right? So I didn't want to miss what God's messenger has come. And as I knelt down, you will be surprised to hear this, I saw the same Zechariah also standing in my room. He stood in my room as much as he was here in the church when Dr. Bruce was sharing. And he laid two scrolls on my table. He said, "Receive this. This is part of the message that you are going to share at this conference." And then he began to pray, he began to prophesy, and some of the things that the Saint Zechariah told me were the words that were coming out of his lips when he was prophesying. Now, these kind of things are unheard of in the normal established church. Do you all agree?
Yes.
So, will that make established people uncomfortable?
Yes.
To suddenly make you feel there's a ghost here? You know, if they can call the Lord Jesus a ghost, he came walking on the water, and all the disciples looked and said, "That's a ghost." Right? If they can call the Lord a ghost, they can certainly call you and me as a ghost. My dearly beloved brothers and sisters, let me emphasize one more time again. Our eyes have not seen, our ears have not heard what God has prepared for these last days. You know, sometimes when we are persecuted like this, we are very hesitant to talk any further. Some years ago, Neville and I decided, let's zip it up. Many years ago, we decided, enough of all this. Let's just zip it up. You know, whatever blessings or heritage we are receiving from the Lord, let it be just within our confines. When we meet one another, we share, we discuss, and that's it. Let's not talk about this anymore. Why throw pearls, you know? And then we were together in Alabama for a conference. In that conference, an angel of the Lord came towards me and said, "Don't hold back whatever God has shown." So I Neville was standing beside me and I poked him. I said, "You know, this angel just came up to me and said this." He looked at me with an ashen look on his face and said, "You too heard that?" So that day we decided, okay, we will not zip up anymore. We will just speak. There will always be ears to hear and eyes to see.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Okay. And as we keep on speaking, the years went by. And especially in the last few years, when God began to do more new things and reveal more new things, more revelations. You know, before the culmination of the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, God is going to make known the riches of His glory, of the things in heaven and the things in the Word of God, which our eyes have not seen, our ears have not heard, neither has it entered into our mind. And as we keep on sharing this, so did the persecution increased, you know? And I faced a lot of persecution. You know, a whole bunch of pastors in India and elsewhere forming associations just for me. How blessed I was, you know? Associations and monthly pastoral meetings and gatherings just to criticize me, just to meditate on me. their lunch fellowships, their coffee fellowships is nothing about the Lord, but just talk about me. So I felt so blessed and privileged that I became the talk of their fellowships. You know, my ratings would have gone up. And of course it hurt, won't it?
Yes.
Isn't it? It would. But so I was getting tired of all this again. I was going to a conference in Nigeria in April, and we were going to conduct a youth conference there. One was in Kenya and one was in Nigeria. And just as before we went, you know, my reputation always precedes me wherever I go. So these criticisms went right before me. And this brunt of persecutions, wrong things, they went right before me. And again, pastoral associations were formed in Kenya and Nigeria. And I became like a conference talk. So many of them wanted to close down our conferences. But the lady who invited me to Kenya stood up very strongly. She said, "No, no matter which church stands or falls, we will have this conference." So the conference in Nigeria, in Kenya went through smoothly. And eventually all the pastors who opposed came and apologized for having misunderstood. You know, you just cannot simply listen to all the junk on YouTube. You know, there are the good, the bad, and the ugly on the YouTube. So you must know how to fish only the good. Sometimes people eat the junk more than the good. Just like in America, you know. You eat more junk food than good food. Right? So when I come to America, the same spirit comes upon me. And I end up eating hamburgers every day. So I will tell my host after the meeting, "Let's drive through a hamburger. Let's pick up a hamburger and some fries." What good is a hamburger without fries, right? So, and we end up eating all kinds of junk food, which doesn't make us healthy. So likewise, there are all kinds of junks out there on YouTube. You know, if they post a whole message for you to scrutinize and hear the whole counsel, is okay. But what they do, they just cut pieces and they post on the YouTube to justify their accusations. When just taking a sentence out, of course it will make it talk in any way it wants. Just like how the devil even quoted scripture. See, he was also smart. He knew the scriptures. He knew exactly what scripture to take to counter the Lord Jesus. But of course he only quoted half the scripture. Just like what today editors, you know, there are so many great video editors and audio editors out there in the cyber world. They just cut sentences and then to justify. So anyway, the group of churches in Nigeria decided to boycott our meetings based on all these stuffs. And they announced in all their churches in Lagos, Nigeria, that none of their youths should attend our meetings. Of course, I didn't know all this. And we landed in Lagos, Nigeria, and there were about 450 youths who came from all over Nigeria except Lagos. Because in Lagos, all the churches decided to have a revival meeting on exactly the same dates that we were having our meetings. So whenever I hear such revival meetings, I am doubly happy, because at least for my sake, the churches are having revivals. You know, by opposing, something good comes out of it. So be it, right? At least for once, for my sake, they all gathered to pray. At least once, for my sake, all the pastors get together. The rest of the year, they are fighting like cats and dogs. During those 5 days of the conference, they all get together for one common good, to pray. See, that's something good, right? That's how I see it. So, in Lagos, Nigeria, I was quite discouraged. I decided, you know, why talk about all these heavenly things, the communion of saints, all this angel stuff. Let's all bundle them all up and keep in my suitcase. I will just stick to the word. You know, I decided to be a more word-based than anything else-based message. So I prepared my messages like that. And on the first day of the conference there, while the worship was going on, as I was closing my eyes and praying, of course I was also not grumbling, but pouring out my complaint to the Lord about all this. I said, Lord, this is what's going on in this city, so therefore I will just stick to all this, and please don't give me any revelation. Please don't allow any angel to walk up and down or come up, and or don't let any chariot to come suddenly and show me what things are going to happen. So I was praying like this when I saw the Saint Joel walk up towards me. He came towards me and he looked straight into my eye like a strict father would look and speak to his son. He looked straight into my eyes and he said, you have been trained for 30 years to teach this last day's generation these things. You must not hold back. If you did, God will raise up somebody else to do that job. And that is enough to settle it. So I decided, you know, once again, who cares what comes, what not, don't comes, right? There's always a remnant, always a remnant, you know. We don't care for a crowd. The crowd will always fall into the ditch. But it is the remnant that will always be found together with the Lamb of God on Mount Zion. It's the remnant. So our job is to prepare the remnant for these last days. Amen?
Yes.
So are you the remnant?
Yes.
If you are the remnant, please stand up for a word right now, for a prayer. Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come before your holy presence in the name of our dear Lord Jesus Christ this evening. Thank you, Holy Father, for gathering all your dear children from far and near into this wonderful church this evening. And also to those who are afar away, who are watching this program, this conference through the live telecasts through web streaming. Thank you, Father, for calling those who are yours to be by your side, to be taught by you, and to be prepared by your Spirit to to be made known the deep mysteries of the ages to come. You told your disciples, when they question you, why do you speak in parables? And you said, to them I speak in parables, but to you, the remnant group, the chosen group, the called group, to you I make known the mysteries of the kingdom. And I thank you, Holy Father, as we lift up our holy hands unto you, to give you thanks for such a time as this, where we can gather under your eternal wings, to be prepared by your fires for these last days, to be adorned with a heavenly garment, like how the bride is adorned to meet her bridegroom. Yes. To be made battle ready, like how it is prophesied in the book of Joel chapter 2, the last days army of God, who has been prepared, forged in the fires of the Holy Spirit, battle ready for the last days. Thank you, Holy Father, for gathering your remnant together under your in your nest. We now ask you, as the mother eagle and the father eagle brings pieces of flesh to feed the little eaglets, we now ask you to come and feed us. Feed us the deep things, the mysteries of the kingdom, and the mysteries of the signs of the times, that we may understand the hidden things, that we may understand our purpose, our call, and our position in the last days army of God. Amen. And I thank you, Holy Father, even right now, you have sent some of your special angels of might who are standing all over this auditorium at various places. Thank you, Holy Father. And I pray all those who have ears to hear and eyes to see and minds to understand may perceive and receive the messages these angels are carrying for them. As I'm praying this prayer, I perceive in my spirit right now these mighty angels. They are really huge and mighty, of very high stature and high rank. High stature not just in height, but high stature in their position and rank in heaven. They have come bearing messages to not all, but some of the chosen ones, the called ones who are here. If you will humble yourselves, if you will prepare yourselves, sanctify your minds, sanctify your hearts, sanctify your eyes, sanctify your ears, you will see, you will receive these messages. These angels are bearing scrolls for you to take the next step, which may be a giant leap of faith for you. Thank you, wonderful Lord Jesus. I see more clearly these mighty ones in our midst. They are really dressed in battle-ready garments. Mighty with a red maroon undergarment and metal protection, golden like metal protection all over their bodies, like how a Roman soldier would be dressed. And I made to understand concerning this armor that they are wearing. They say nothing can penetrate this armor. Though it looks normal armor, not very thick, just thin like a normal armor, yet it is so powerful that no weapon of this world nor the weapon of the world to come can penetrate. None of the weapons of the devil can penetrate these armors. And this angel also tells me they have specially come, the many of them that are standing all over this auditorium, but there is the captain of them who is standing right in the center aisle of this church, and in the center aisle and in the middle section of this church. And he says this armor that they are wearing will also be given to those for whom it has been appointed. Especially to those who are in the front line of the ministry, front line of doing works for God. And he now shows me his headgear. He lifts it up and he shows me, said, this is a very important part of the armor. And why it is very important? Because two things. One, it protects the mind of Christ from being corrupted by the things of this world and by the craftiness of the devil. The believer is supposed to possess the mind of Christ. But when the mind is not protected or covered, the darts of the devil can penetrate into your mind, corrupting it and duplicating it to manifest like the mind of Christ. Just like how the craftiness of the devil beguiled Eve to say, twisting the words of God, when he said, when you eat the fruit, you shall surely die. He twisted the fruit, the word, to say, you shall not surely die. Such twisting and corruption will take place in your mind. Humble yourselves like a little child. Have the mind as innocent like a little child, that will be quick to believe the things of the Spirit. Come on, lift up your holy hands and bless the name of the living God right now. Thank you, wonderful God. Now I see him pointing to his feet, and I see the shoes that he's wearing. It is dark silvery, but very strong. very robust, like a military soldier's thick boots. But this is armor. It's all covered. And it says, these are for the purpose of, like how the prophet Elijah was told, the walk that he needs to walk is very long. And he walked for 40 days and 40 nights in the strength of the angel's foot. Likewise, you need to be adorned with this foot, because your walk in this world, in these last days, should not be corrupted by the devil, by the ways of the world, to walk in its ways. You need to put on the shoes so that as the angels walk in the ways of God, so should the last day's army walk in the ways of God. Thank you, wonderful God. Oh, we lift up our holy hands unto you, and we bless your holy name. You are a good God. Your grace and mercy endures forever and ever. I love you, Lord, and I live my words to worship you, my soul rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you need. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound. Let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Open the eyes of our understanding, Lord. Give us an understanding mind and a listening heart, that we may hear what the Spirit of God is speaking to the churches in these last days. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. If you have your Bibles with you, please turn with me to the book of Isaiah, the chapter 62. You know, you have been hearing in this conference from the first night and this morning that God is doing a new thing. And our dear brother Neville Johnson started his message with that, and so did our dear brother Dr. Bruce. He went on to elaborate on that, and we will continue. As I was waiting on God, asking what word I should bring, and this is what the Lord told me yesterday, to share with you the new thing that God is going to do, which will begin from this year. And this year would be a year of preparation to prepare ourselves to receive that which is new that God is going to give. So what is the thing? The word of the Lord came unto me. He said, this is the year. Time to prepare for God's glory. You've been hearing this for years. We have been preaching this conference year after year after year. the coming of the glory of God, not twofold, but sevenfold. You remember that? Remember, not twofold, but sevenfold. It's coming, it's coming, it's coming. It has been prophesied for long. Now we say to you, it is now near. It's right at the door. If it's right at the door, you want to be ready. Just like what the Lord Jesus said in Revelation chapter 3 verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anyone who has ears to hear. See, for you to hear the knock, you must be standing near the door. If you are far away from the door, you may not hear. So you need to be always watching and waiting when the knock will come. And you also want to be dressed and ready. You don't want to be caught in your nighties, do you? Or in your pajamas? No. Because when the king comes, or the king's messenger comes with a message for you, and when you open the door, it is going to be a message of a marching order. So you should be battle ready. You cannot say, oh, let me go and dress and get ready. You cannot say, let me go first prepare a funeral for my family. That's what one guy told the Lord Jesus, and the Lord said, let the dead bury the dead. You just follow me. Which talks of a period or a time of preparedness. You cannot say, no, give me some time. Let me go and take care of all my family business first. And when I'm retired, I have all the time for you, Lord. It'll be too late. Be too late. There is no guarantee that you can survive your retirement. You can die along the way. Right? Who can guarantee that you live to 62 or 65? In India, it's 58. You can't guarantee anything. Death can take place anytime, anywhere. Right? But a life of preparedness will make you ready all the time. So once you hear the knock on the door and you are ready, say, speak, Lord, for your servant shall hear. For you to say, speak, Lord, for your servant will hear, it means you are ready to act upon whatever the master will speak to you. And that was the counsel given by Eli to little Samuel, who was about 5 years old. And he said, the next time you hear the voice of God, just say, speak, Lord, for your servant shall hear. And the third time when the Lord spoke, little Samuel, 5-year-old boy, stood up, folded his hands and said, speak, Lord, for your servant shall hear. And the Lord spoke to him a long word of prophecy, as the Lord would speak to an older, much more matured prophet. You know, I don't want to say I had a problem with that. I was wondering, and I asked the Lord this question. You know, Lord, this passage is a little puzzling to me. I said, how can a small little 5-year-old boy understand the length or the maturity of the word of prophecy that you just spoke? And the Lord looked at me and he said, a prophet need not understand, a prophet has to just speak. See, just like the speakers that you see up here, the speaker is just portraying whatever I'm speaking. Does the speaker ever pause to ponder? Say, wait, let me process what you are saying. And then let me analyze first. Should I release this or should I not? Does the speaker do all that? No. The speaker's job, his purpose of creation, is just to broadcast, speak out, or proclaim whatever the speaker is speaking. That's why it is called a speaker. Right? In the same way, it's a prophet. It may not make sense to him. It need not be his job. It's just simply to say what God speaks. That's what a prophet's job is. And that's what this last day's remnant company should do. You cannot analyze what is this or what is that. You just do what you are told to do. See, like for example, the apostle Peter saw the Lord Jesus walking on the water. And he wanted to test whether is this the Lord Jesus himself. Because in the beginning thought, it was a ghost. So he said, if you be the Lord, command me to walk on the water. Now why did the apostle Peter say that? Because prior to that, he has seen the Lord Jesus simply speaking the word and a miracle has come to pass. So, remembering all that, he told the Lord, if you are the Lord, now speak the word. That word will hold me and make me walk on the water. So the Lord just simply looked and said, come. Just one word, come. And he stepped out on the water, first putting one foot to test and see whether the water will really hold him up. And when it held him up, he grew confident and he took a few steps until he became so self-centered. He thought he was doing this miracle by himself and not by the power of the living God. That's when he began to sink under. You see, I have been told many, many times by many of the saints of old, the prophets of the old, whom we call the cloud of witnesses, they have repeatedly told me the reason why they are making their appearances to this last day's remnant and they are sharing counsel. The one real purpose is we should not fail where they failed. You know, several years ago, I was called by the Lord to fast and pray in Jerusalem for 7 days. And on one of those days, the prophet Elijah appeared to me and he spoke to me at length about the workings of the spirit of Jezebel. And as he was about to finish, he told me, he said, where I failed, you, meaning representing the last days generation, you should not fail. So I looked at him, I was surprised. I said, Father, what do you mean you failed? You didn't fail, you were raptured up. He said, yes, I failed. I ran away from Jezebel instead of cutting her head. See, he cut the heads of 850 false prophets. She should have been 851. Instead, her one word, this day, tomorrow, I'll have your head. Because that's what Elijah did. And she threatened him with the same dire consequences like what he did to the others. Hearing those words, he chickened out. And he ran away for fear of his own life rather than confronting her and using the sword to cut her. So he failed there. So where he failed, because this last day's prophetic generation is going to encounter not only the spirit of Jezebel, but the spirit of Ashtaroth and Jezebel together. Together. You know, Ashtaroth and Jezebel together is going to be a mighty force to contend with. So that is why God is sending Elijah the prophet again in these last days. You read that in Malachi chapter 4, verse 5 and 6. I will send you Elijah, meaning he will send that anointing of Elijah to come. And that anointing will equip you, empower you to do many times more than what he did. When he failed, we cannot fail. We should not fail. When he failed, he had a second chance. When we fail, we have no chance, because this is the last lap. Last lap. When this is the last lap, you have no other chance. You know, right now the Olympics is going on in Rio de Janeiro. Have you been watching it? Okay, you know the medal tally? US is in the lead. You should be very happy and proud. Every day I look at the tally. Who is winning how many goals? Anyway, you know this relay race where there are two kinds, 4 by 100 or 4 by 400. Let's take the 4 by 100. There are four runners who will complete one race. The first guy and the last guy should be the most fastest in the entire team. If the first guy misses the baton for a second or two, there is chance for the second guy to pick up. If the second guy misses the baton for a second or two, the third guy has a chance to pick up again, and it will cause him to run a little more faster. But the fourth guy cannot afford to miss the baton, because there's no one else to help him. He is the last. So is this generation, the last generation. You cannot afford to lay down the baton, to lose the baton, or to even hold the baton loosely. You should hold it tightly. Hold fast to your profession. Hold fast. Hold tightly to your call, to your profession, to your confession, to what you have been hold, because you will be shaken with all that you have been taught, with all that you have been known. You'll be shaken. All things that can be shaken will be shaken, so that the things that cannot be shaken will remain. Everything else will be shaken. Your family will be shaken. Your life will be shaken. Your future will be shaken. Your career will be shaken. Your churches will be shaken. Your ministry will be shaken. You yourself will be shaken. Only one thing will remain till the end. Your complete childlike faith in the Lord. That is why the Bible says, strengthen the things that remain. Strengthen your faith. Because that's the only thing that's going to carry you through the persecution that's going to come. You're not going to escape that persecution. So get ready. It is coming. The church will go through that persecution of fire, because that fire will purify the church. It will purify the believers. You know, all this talk about we will escape all this persecution, it's just rubbish. I used to think like that. You know, every sincere Pentecostal believer or preacher knows by heart, without looking at the Bible, that the rapture will take place before anything else. Right? I'm sure you have held those old age thinking. I thought like that because I belong to the old school Pentecostal school, you know. We've been taught like that until the year 2006. In 2006, I was preaching at a convention in South India. And I was praying that morning, asking the Lord what I should share that evening. And the Lord Jesus came to me and he said, open your Bible and look at Matthew 24 verse 8. So I looked at the scripture. It says, all these are but the beginnings of sorrows. So I said, Lord, what is this? This is a good news convention. You are supposed to preach good news. Right? You don't say, these are the beginnings of sorrows. That's not good news. That's bad news. And the Lord went through the chapter 24 of every event that is going to take place in the last days. And then he went through with me Matthew chapter 24 and the books of Revelation. And that's when he said the church will go through the fire. I said, Lord, this is contrary. What you are telling me now is contrary to whatever we have known. And he said, all you guys are wrong. All you guys are wrong. Said, I never said in my word the rapture will be before the tribulation. Did he? No. This is how we interpreted it. Right? Because we like to escape all these things. Said, you are wrong. It will go through. It will go through the fire. That will be the last final test of our allegiance.
Amen.
You know, you all are very smart people, aren't you? No?
Yes.
Why do you give me a stare then? Are you smart people?
Yes.
Okay. I'll give you a simple math, okay? It's a simple math. Not very difficult, rocket science. Now you just listen to me very carefully and use your logical reasoning now. If all the good people, good Christians, those who are walking with the Lord, they all are raptured, all gone. And only the nominal Christians and all the evil ones are left behind. Okay? Why force them to take the mark of the beast? Why force them? Because they all are prepared to take the mark of the beast. Why force them? Because they'll all be psycho-conditioned. They'll all be taught to receive and to know that the mark of the beast is okay. You know, I was just told by a minister of God in Singapore about a church elder of one of the largest church in Singapore. And the elder spoke with this minister of God that I know, a friend of mine, say, it is nothing wrong to take the mark of the beast. He is an elder in the largest church in Singapore. For the elder to speak like that, what must the church be teaching? Right?
Right.
This minister friend of mine was shocked to hear this. He said, what do you mean it's okay? Yeah, he said, of course it's okay. Because God knows our hearts. Wrong. You see, this is the ploy of the devil.
Yes.
This is the subtle trickery of the devil. To deceive you into thinking, oh, the flesh is weak. God knows your heart. Just take the mark. It's after all in your hand, not in your heart. You see? But what goes in your hand is what goes into your heart. So if all the good people are gone, why meet the false prophet and the antichrist force the people to take the mark of the beast? No need to. Right? No need to. But for him to force the people, the remnant must be here. Right? The remnant must be here. And then remnant will refuse to take the mark of the beast. And many of the remnant, according to Revelation chapter 20, will be beheaded. They die as martyrs because they refuse to take the mark of the beast. Then there will be another remnant who will be given great wings like an eagle to fly into the wilderness to a place that has been prepared for her, protected. Now that knocks out all this pre-tribulation rapture teaching. Right, everybody?
Yes.
It knocks it out. Clean and out. Knock out in the first round. Don't have to go through all the rounds till the last result. Don't have to. First round out. You know, that was what the how the Lord corrected me that day in the year 2006. But of course, you know, you can choose not to believe this. You can choose to believe in the pre-trip, mid-trip, or post-trip. There are three confusing doctrines or views, you know, pre-tribulation rapture, mid-tribulation rapture, post-tribulation rapture. Even the Pentecostals are not united in this. They are so confused. So I remember, you know, in 1991, when I first visited the U.S., I was preaching at a convention in St. Louis, Missouri. And this wonderful woman of God, Gwen Shaw, who invited me to the conference, she asked me a question. She said, you know, you have seen the Lord, you have heard many revelations from the Lord. Can you tell us when is the rapture? I said, yes, madam, I can surely answer that question. I said, this is part of my message. So I went on with my message and then I came to this thing. You know, whether you believe pre-trip, mid-trip or post-trip, if you want to take a trip, the most important criteria is getting ready. What's the use? You are so well-versed and theologically sound in pre-trip or mid-trip or post-trip, but you are not ready. What's the use? So if pre-trip is right, the most important thing is be ready. If mid-trip is right, most important, be ready. If post-trip is right, most important, be ready. Whenever, whichever the trip is, as long as you are ready, you will hear the trumpet sound and you will be caught up. Amen.
Amen.
So why fight over dry bones like dogs? We are not dogs, are we?
No.
No. You are created in the image of God. We should behave like children of God and not behave like dogs. Do you? So, it's time to prepare for glory. Isaiah 62, verses 10 to 12. Go through the gates. Prepare the way for the people. Now mark that word. Prepare the way for the people. Prepare what? Prepare the way for the glory to come. Build them up. Build up the highway so that the glory can come. Take out the stones. Take out the things that are offensive in your life. The things that cause you to stumble. The things that cause you to fall. Those stumbling stones in your life. Take it away. Remove it far from your life. Lift up a banner. Lift up the standard. A standard of righteousness. A standard of holiness. And a standard of the fear of God for the people. Indeed, the Lord has proclaimed to the end of the earth, say to the daughter of Zion, surely your salvation is coming. Behold, his reward is with him. What is the reward? The reward of the pouring out of the glory. And his work before him. Now look at this play of words there. Behold, his reward is with him. And his work before him. You are rewarded to do the work that is before you. So the glory of God that is going to be poured out is for the work that you have to do. That is before you. That is going to come. That will be made known to you in these last days. And they shall call them the holy people. That is the remnant group. Not everyone. Not all believers are the bride of Christ. Not all. Every believer is part of the body of Christ.
but not all are part of the bride of Christ. Only they who make themselves ready, only they are the bride, not all. And they shall be called the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord. And you shall be called sought out, a city not forsaken. When you are filled with the glory of God, when you are covered with the glory of God, when you are infused with the glory of God, in the last days, you will be a person or a people or a church or a ministry that will be sought out. Number one. Number two, your church or your ministry will become a city not forsaken, meaning it becomes a city of refuge for others to come and take refuge there. It's not only a church or a ministry, but also individuals. You will open up your homes. It will become like a city not forsaken, a home of refuge. I'm sure you may have heard of Corrie Ten Boom. Have you? She's one single woman who saved many, many Jews from Hitler's Holocaust. One woman who hid many Jews in a home. And I'm sure you may have seen the movie Schindler's List. And this one man, Schindler, he too saved many Jews. One man. So, you one person, your home can also become a city of refuge in the last days. You know, when the people of God will be heavily persecuted, and where they will be hunted like an hunted animal, where they will be running from pillar to post, no place to stay, churches closed down. God has chosen some places, some churches, some cities, some people's homes to be places of refuge for the people of God to go and hide. When they, such designated places of refuge, I have seen in the spirit, God builds a wall of fire all around them that will shield the eyes of the enemy from the existence of such a place. It will be protected because it's a place of refuge. And the enemy's eyes are blinded. They can't see that. You know, there are two accounts in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ when the people planned to throw him down a cliff. And the Bible says he just walked through the midst of the people and he was invisible. See, this is one of the last days anointing. Not only Harry Potter has that clock, you know. God also has his wings. His wings that covers you, and you will be invisible to the eyes of your persecutors. Your church, your ministry, and your house will become invisible. It's a real house, but to the enemy, they are invisible. They will look as if it didn't exist at all. But a building like this will exist, and people will be gathered here. And the angels of God will come there to feed you, like how they fed Elijah with food from heaven. You know, the food that the angel brought was not something from McDonald's. Because by eating food from McDonald's, you cannot walk for 40 days and 40 nights. Right? That junk food may just last you for a couple of hours. But this food that the angel brought two times strengthened him, spirit, soul, and body, and enabled him to walk not just the day and sleep in the night, day and night, continuously from Carmel all the way down up to Mount Sinai in Egypt. A length for several hundreds of miles, non-stop, which is humanly impossible. The angels of God will be there in your midst. Let's say in a church like this, and they will feed you with the divine manna. You know, you read in the book of Revelation, to one of the church, the Lord Jesus said, I will give you the hidden manna. Now, manna is something to be eaten, right? So he said, I will give you the hidden manna because you are under persecution. You have no food to eat. You cannot buy any food because without the mark of the beast, you cannot buy or sell. No business transaction. Your credit cards won't work. Because the only credit card that you can carry is the number or the mark on your hand or on your forehead. And do you know, the world is now slowly shifting towards that. In the past, you know, when you have a computer or a laptop, you just key in a password to open your system. Then it transitioned into laptops that have fingerprint access, right? So now you, instead of a password, you just put your fingerprint and the scanner goes, and it reads you and say, okay, cleared. Now, the modern laptops have iris scan recognition system. See, it progressed from a password to fingerprint, now to iris scan. So now you put your eyes, look straight into the and it goes to your retina, scans your retina, and say you are cleared. So what is the next? The next is just wave your hand because you'll have the mark here. Or show your forehead because the mark is there. See how we are being psycho-conditioned from place to place. We have been psycho-conditioned so that when the mark eventually comes, we will be so fooled, we'll be so comfortable, and we'll be so deep and deceived into thinking this is a better choice. A better choice. Because if you have a credit card, the card can be stolen. You can lose the card. You can leave the card at home and you go to the supermarket, suddenly you realize you forgot your card. But you have the card in your, if you have the number in your hand goes with you wherever it goes. Right? You know, the Indians eat with their hands. So yesterday, my secretary asked me, why do Indians eat with their hands? I said, the answer is very simple. The hand is with you all the time. You know, the fox and the knife, you don't know where it went. A person with some terrible sickness could have used it. Right? But your hand, you know, it's with you all the time. So it's always clean and hygienic. So learn to eat with your hands. So, we are being progressively psycho-conditioned to accept this transition as if it is just part of the next progressive being a smart people. Now you have smart nation, smart cities, you have smartphones, you don't have smart people. That is why we have smartphones. Right? See, the phones are so smart today. They remember everything except us. How many of you remember the numbers of your family members? We don't anymore. We don't. We all depend on the smartphones because we are not smart. So they want to make smart people. How to make them smart people? Put a chip in your hand. And you know, years ago the Lord showed me, once you get the chip in your hand, the Antichrist will talk to everybody at the same time wirelessly with a chip in your hand. Let me give you an example. Now you have a phone. When the phone company wants to send a message to you, they don't call you up individually. They send you a text message, right? One press of a button, say 100,000 subscribers to this particular phone company will all receive a message at the same time in just seconds because of the SIM card in the phone. In the same manner with the Antichrist SIM card mark in your hand, he will likewise communicate with everybody at the same time through the chip, wirelessly. And then you can be told what to do. You can be told what to expect. You can be told where to go, what to do. That is why the Bible says, he who takes the mark of the beast, there is no more repentance for him. No more. Because you become like a zombie. Once you take the mark, you are a zombie. Don't think you can cut out the mark out. No, you can't do that. It's part of your system now. It's part of you. So don't ever be deceived by any manner of technological talk saying, oh, it's harmless. Whenever you don't like it, you can just remove it. Those are just lies. Lies. So how do we prepare for this glory? What is God going to do? God is going to pour forth his seven spirits upon his true believers. Now, what are the seven spirits? Isaiah chapter 11 verse 2. And the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. The seven spirits of God. God is going to pour out the seven spirits upon, not the whole world, although it will be poured out upon the whole world, but it will come upon his true believers, the remnant people. So we should prepare ourselves to receive this. You know, in the year 1994, I was waiting on God one day, and the Lord Jesus appeared before me, and he said, today is your birthday. I totally forgot about that day. And I have come to bless you and give you a gift. So he handed me a small little box, the size of, you know, when you go to a jeweler, you buy a ring. You know the small box? It was about that size. And it was nicely wrapped up with a wrapper that was greenish and orangey. And then it was tied with a ribbon that was also of the same color. So he handed me the box. He said, this is your gift. Open and see. You know, in our Indian culture, when somebody gives you a gift, you don't immediately open in front of them. You open when they all are gone, so that nobody sees your excitement. So I took the gift and I wanted to keep it and look at it after the Lord is gone. But he said, open it. So I open it. I remove the ribbon. I remove the wrapper. And when I opened the box, I was very, very shocked. I was hoping to see some kind of a ring made in heaven. And I saw only a piece of paper there. On it was written, Isaiah 11:2. And the Lord said, you have been praying for this gift for 10 years. Today, I come to bless you with this gift. So saying that, he laid out his hand on my head and he prayed a prayer and an impartation of a blessing of the seven spirits of God. Then I asked the Lord, but I don't know anything about these seven spirits of God. Please teach me. And for the next 1.5 hours, the Lord sat and taught me what the seven spirits of God are all about. So I ended up writing a book called On Eagle's Wings, which details about the seven spirits of God, what they are, how you can receive them, what you should do to receive them, and how each of the seven spirits
works they manifest from many, many biblical illustrations and examples, and how we can identify the manifestation of this gift in our life, and also to enhance the anointing and to increase the power and the intensity of the workings of this gift. So I originally preached this message at our brother Neville's church in the year 1995, I think, and that was the first time that I ever taught this publicly. And then subsequently I taught this at this church in some years ago. And later on, when I sat down to write this book, the Lord had given me many, many more understanding from 1994 till now. So this is one book you want to get so that you can understand about the workings of these gifts. I saw once, early this year, the Lord Jesus Christ dressed in a 7-colored robe. And when I looked at him, I understood the 7-colored robe represented the 7 spirits of God. And he spoke to me and he said, "What you know about the 7 spirits of God," which he was referring to the things that were shown to me in 1994, "is a little of the larger anointings of the 7 spirits. What you have so far received is one portion, but there are several other aspects of the anointings of the 7 spirits of God, which God will make manifest to known to us in greater detail in these last days." If you read Zechariah chapter 4, there the prophet Zechariah sees a vision of 2 lampstands and 2 olive trees. And the lampstands were pouring out its oil. And from the 7 bowls on the lampstand, oil was being poured out. The Lord told me, the pouring out of the oil from the 7 bowls of the lampstand represents one aspect of the anointing of the Holy Spirit, or manifestation of the 7 spirits of God, where it is called the oiled anointing. Then if you read Revelation chapter 4, verse 5 and 6, the apostle John saw before the throne of God 7 lamps burning, and the 7 lamps were in 7 different colors, and that 7 lamps represents the 7 spirits of God, and that is another anointing, the fire, anointing of fire from the 7 spirits. Then in Revelation chapter 5 verse 6, John saw the Lamb of God with 7 horns and 7 eyes. And the scripture says the 7 eyes and the 7 horns represents the 7 spirits of God that are sent out to all the world. Now the 7 eyes is of another anointing, the anointing of the eyes. And the 7 horns represents another anointing, the 7 horns anointing. Now all these are different manifestations of the 7 spirits of God, and there are 7 of them, 7 manifestations of the 7 spirits of God, which God will make known to us in the last days. So far I have been graced by God to receive revelation and understanding about the 7 horns. And a friend of mine, a prophet of God in India, received a revelation from God in the year 2010 about the 7 eyes anointing. Now there are more, the 7 lamps, then the 7 oils. So when we begin to flow in it, God will begin to pour out these 7 spirits of God upon the church.
the bride is going to be caught away in rapture. We talked about that earlier. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verses 15 to 17 talks about that. So because the bride is going to be caught away, we must get ready. Purify ourselves. See, the bride who has made herself ready, the Bible tells us in Revelation chapter 19 verses 7, 8 and 9 that she was given a robe which was clean and white. Cleanliness, outward cleanliness of the body, where all the works of the flesh are crucified. And white signifies of the holiness of the heart. Yesterday you heard Brother Neville share that without holiness, without purity of heart, no one can see God. And how he shared very candidly that there are many people in heaven who have never even seen God because there's no purity of heart. For the bride to walk hand in hand with the bridegroom, she must be clean on the outside and pure in the inside. Only then you can qualify to be the bride. So we want to make ourselves ready to be the bride. Secondly, God is going to ask for an account to reckon from us for all the giftings that he has given us thus far. If you read the parable that the Lord Jesus spoke in Luke chapter 16 verses 1 to 2, the parable about the dishonest manager, the Lord put him in charge, or his boss put him in charge of a company, but he was very dishonest. But the day came when the manager, the owner, came back and asked him to account for himself what he has done. So before the glory can be poured out upon us, we must give an account to God. What have we done so far with the little that has been given unto us, or the little that we know? What have we done so far? Have you lived such a life for the Lord that will warrant him to count you worthy to receive this? Let me give you one example. A couple of weeks ago, one of my staff's mother was dying, and that lady is about 73, 75 years old, and she was very sickly. All her life, she's a very sickly woman. Whenever she gets very close to death, this staff of mine will ask me to pray for her, and miraculously the woman will be healed and come to life. And this time again she came very close to death, and my staff called me and she cried on the phone, said, "Please pray for my mother, she's dying." So I said, "All right, let me pray." As I was praying, I could never pray a prayer of healing for that woman. Instead, I found myself saying, "Lord, prepare her to meet you." And that sentence came out continuously out of my mouth. You know, even though if I tried to say, "Lord, heal her," the words kept on coming, "Lord, prepare her to meet you. Prepare her spirit, prepare her body, prepare her understanding so that she can meet you." And then when finally I said, "Amen," and this staff asked me, "Will my mother be healed?" So I said, "Don't worry, my daughter. Everything will be all right." Again she asked me, "Will my mother be healed?" I said, "Don't worry, my daughter. Everything will be all right." And the third time she asked me this question, and the third time I repeated the same thing. You know, I could not bring myself to say, "No, your mother is going to die." No, I just prayed a prayer that your mother, when she closes her eyes, her soul will be ready to meet the Lord. And though I was camouflaging my answer, She understood me because she has been working for me for 20 years. She knows my lingo, you know. You know, when I answer other people's questions, she's been standing there watching the language that I use, the words that I use, and she knows this sentence means that. So she cried and she said, please tell me the truth. Will my mother be healed? So I told her, my dear daughter, your mother is already very old. Why let her live again and go through all the pain? Just let your mother go. She said, no, I cannot let my mother go. You must pray a prayer and heal my mother. So I assured her, okay, don't worry. Before I go to bed tonight, because she called me at about 10 in the night, you know. Before I go to bed, I promise you, I'll pray for your mother. So that settled it. And before, I remember the promise I made. So I knelt down to pray. I said, Lord, you know this. I told the whole situation to the Lord. And the Lord asked me a question. See, I stood before the Lord's presence in heaven. And he asked me, what profit is she to my kingdom for me to extend her life? I had no answer. Because I know this old woman, all her life, she's just been a good mother, a good wife, and a very nominal believer, period. She has not done anything worthy for the Lord. All her life, she's been taking care of her family, a large family, and then the many grandchildren. All her life was limited to her family. Nothing worthwhile for the kingdom of God. So the Lord asked me, why should I extend her life? For what worth is she to my kingdom? And he said, furthermore, she has lived her life. See, the scripture says, you shall live for 70 or at the most 80. So she qualified. You know, how to argue now against all that? So I pleaded with the Lord. I said, Lord, you promised 70 and 80, right? So this woman has another 7 more years. So I pleaded with the Lord. I said, this one time, Lord, extend her life. This one time. I will never ask you again. So he looked at me and he asked me, how many more years do you want me to extend her? I remembered Hezekiah, and I wanted to say, you see, the thought came to my mind, 15, but out of my mouth came the word 3. Look, don't stone me. So I told the Lord, Lord, extend her life for 3 more years. And the Lord looked at me and said, because you ask, I will do it for you. He said, go, she'll be healed. And the next day, or a few days later, I heard from my staff, her mother is so well and good and healed. You see, we need to give an account of our life. What is the life you are living? Do you think you are born in this world just to grow, have a college education, have a family, and then be a housewife, look after your kids, look after your grandchildren, period? Is that why God made you? No. You have been made, like what Neville said last night, to demonstrate the glory of the kingdom of God. So your life must count. Either, if not in big way, at least in small way. You know, early this year, my mother crossed 75 and she was showing signs of some deterioration in her health. And I wasn't praying for her health ever since
my father died 3 years ago, I could see some withdrawal symptoms in her. Now she became very quiet, she became a little withdrawn. She was never like that. I noticed all that ever since my father died. Then this year, on January the 1st, when I was praying, the Lord told me, tell your mother to get ready to meet me. So tell her how she should prepare herself, to prepare her soul, to prepare herself to meet me, which means her time will come to die. So I called my mother. Of course, I didn't say she's going to die, you know. So I just said, you know, the Lord Jesus is coming very soon. We all don't know how long we will all live. So now you are also advancing in age. So why don't you now put your life right and put away all other things. Forget about caring for your grandchildren. Forget about caring for all your children. Just now focus on preparing your soul, purifying it, preparing it to meet the Lord. And ever since, in the last 8 months now, she has done that. She's put away everything else. She stopped visiting the children, stopped visiting the grandchildren. She just watches our television network day and night. She prays every day. I mean, not that she wasn't praying before. She has doubled it up. And then she does ministry. She goes with our women's group to visit old folks' home and bring words of encouragement, words of healing. And she joins a prayer network to intercede and to pray for the people. See, making yourselves worthwhile for the kingdom of God, even in your gray age. No one is useless in the kingdom of God. So prepare yourselves to give an account. Next, God's army is going to rise up mightily. So therefore, prepare them. Joel chapter 2, verse 11. We'll talk more about this tomorrow and in the next session that I will have. The seven spirits are seven anointings that are going to be poured out upon this world. When these seven anointings are poured out, it will raise up seven groups of people, among whom are children, youths, senior citizens, and ministers. Seven groups of angels have been appointed to oversee this outpouring. Now, if you read Revelation chapter 15, verses 5 to 8, you'll read about seven angels bearing seven bowls of the wrath of God to be poured out upon this world. So when God does something important, He appoints seven angels to do those works. You read about seven angels who blow the seven trumpets. You read about seven angels who pour the vials of God. And then seven angels who pour the wrath of God. So they are always in multiples of sevens. Now these seven groups of angels will go into the churches and prepare them to receive the seven spirits of God. The churches need to be prepared to receive. They will point out, how will these angels prepare the churches? They will point out shortcomings in the churches and prepare the believers to receive the anointing. Now let me give you two examples about angelic work in this area of pointing out shortcomings and preparing the people for receiving the glory. First example is found in Luke chapter 1, verses 18 to 20. You'll read about the angel Gabriel come and talk to Zacharias, the father of John the Baptist, about a son that is going to be born. And then Zechariah opens his mouth and speaks out a word of unbelief. As soon as he said that, Gabriel will point out his shortcoming and rebuke him for his unbelief. Secondly,
The same angel Gabriel appeared to Mary in Luke chapter 1 verses 26 to 38, and he speaks to her about the coming Messiah who is going to be born in her. Now what he spoke prepared her to receive the Son of God in her womb. So you have two examples now: the work of the angel to point out shortcomings, and the work of angels to prepare us to receive the glory. Now, just as the Lord Jesus went to prepare a place for his people to stay with him, likewise, we should prepare a place in our church, within us, for the seven spirits to come and dwell in us. If you read Mark chapter 14, verses 12 to 16, and on the first day of unleavened bread, when they sacrificed the Passover lamb, his disciples said to him, "Where will you have us go and prepare for you to eat the Passover?" And he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. And wherever he enters, say to the master of the house." Now please note the next sentence. The teacher says, "Where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?" And verse 15 says, this man had prepared a large room. He had prepared and furnished a large room to receive the Lord Jesus and the disciples. Now the man did not know who was coming, but he prepared and furnished. In the same way, you need to prepare yourselves. Furnish yourself with the word of God. Furnish yourself speaking in the spirit. That will make you very, very spirit conscious. You should spend at least 1 hour a day praying in unknown tongues. The more you pray in unknown tongues, the more spirit conscious you will become. Not only that, your spiritual eyes will be enlightened. It will become brighter and sharper to see things in the spirit. Once your eyes become sharper and brighter, you will no more say, "You know, when I saw this vision, I do not know whether it's this or that." You don't have to say like that, because your eyes will see them crystal clear in high definition. Don't you want that?
Yes.
The only way to sharpen your spiritual eyes and sharpen your spiritual ears and sharpen your spiritual sensitivity is by praying in unknown tongues more and more. Minimum 1 hour. The more, the better. You know, once I did a research. What will happen to me if I prayed continuously in unknown tongues for 8 hours a day, 12 hours a day, 14 hours a day, 24 hours a day? What will happen? So I journal. When I began to pray, I journal from hour to hour what was happening inside me. And I began to realize my eyes were getting sharper by the hour. And eventually, on the second day, I saw open visions all over the room. Anywhere I turned, in 360 degrees, it was like even before there was this technology of high definition. Now, this was in 1992. High definition only came out recently, in 2009. But then I saw this huge vision, open vision, in whichever direction that I turn around, all over the room in 360 degrees. And that was just 2 days of praying continuously in unknown tongues. What if you do it all your life? Then forever you are living in an open vision atmosphere. Amen. It is absolutely possible. And anyone, whether young or old, young or old, not only in physical age, but in spiritual age, when you do this, when you do this spiritual discipline and this spiritual exercise, you will be more than a conqueror. You will transcend or transit from an ordinary believer to become a seer. Not only with your ears, your eyes, but also your ears. You can hear of what the enemy speaks miles away, even across continents. That was the gift that was upon Elisha. You know, he was in Israel, but he could hear what the king of Syria was speaking in his bedroom. It beats any of CIA's eavesdropping equipment. It will put all of their equipment to shame, because you don't need any devices. All you need is ears of the Spirit. And any secrets, even the whisper of the heart, even the thoughts of the mind, they speak and you will hear them. Can you believe this?
Yes.
They all speak loud, you know. You know, before I came to this conference here, I was fasting and praying in Singapore. And one day, I had a visitation from this wheel that you read of in Ezekiel chapter 1. And it says there are eyes all over the wheels. And as I was looking at this wheel, one eye among all the eyes stood out and he just looked at me. And as I was looking at the eye spoke. I was wondering, how can an eye speak? But this eye spoke to me. You know, do you have a theology for that?
No.
Is this unbiblical? No. You all are so quiet. Is this unbiblical?
No.
But in Ezekiel chapter 1, you will read, the Spirit of God is in the wheels. And if the Spirit is there, is the Holy Spirit, he can speak. Right?
Yes.
The seeing eye also speaks. Hey, if a donkey can speak, how much more? A donkey is a creation on this earth. If the donkey can speak, how much more things in heaven? Everything has a voice. A trumpet speaks in heaven. A trumpet only makes sound. Right? You know, we have wonderful instruments here. Keyboard, a piano, a drum, and some other instruments are missing. They were here last time. This, you know, when our dear sister Jean and John plays the keyboard, you hear nice sounds of piano that comes out of the keyboard. Have you ever heard the piano opening instrument say, "Then sings my soul"? The piano doesn't speak like that. But in Revelation chapter 1, you read a trumpet spoke with John. A trumpet, instead of making a sound, it spoke with John. And then you read in Revelation chapter 15 that the four horns on the altar spoke. A horn. How can a horn speak? But the horn spoke. And then in Revelation chapter 10, you read of thunders speaking. You, on this earth, you only hear the sound of a thunder, the pealing thunder sound. But in heaven, the thunder speaks. Everything that has the breath of God has a voice. Amen. It has a voice. When your ears are circumcised, when they become very highly spiritually sensitized, you can hear. And speaking in tongues will enhance that ability of yours to hear. And thirdly, speaking in tongues increases your spiritual sensitivity. Before your eye sees, you will now perceive in your spirit, okay, someone is here. And then you open your eyes to your right or to your left, you see an angel of God standing or some heavenly beings. First your spirit picks it up, you know, then your eye sees, then your ears hear. So all these things, for your spiritual sensitivity to increase, for your spiritual eyes to be enlightened, for your spiritual ears to increase in its audibility, the shortcut or the foundation is speaking in unknown tongues. It increases your spiritual sensitivity. Even it increases your faith. That's what the Bible says. If you want to have more faith, don't pray for it. Just pray in unknown tongues. Amen.
Amen.
Finally, when the Lord spoke, prepare the people for glory, He showed me a vision of what is happening in heaven and how heaven is preparing to pour out the glory. And I saw a glorious place in heaven which was filled with glory. And there were many angels coming forth with bowls in their hands, all carrying that spirit, seven spirits of God to pour out. And I also saw eagles, bright golden white eagles, flying all over in heaven, which are the prophet saints who take on the form of eagles. They were flying forth from that place to come to visit us, to prepare us and teach us for the journey that we need to walk. You know, nature tells us when an eagle goes through a molting process, it is almost like in a dead position. It cannot, it's all ball, it's all bleeding, and its beak is broken, its talons are all fallen over. It's like almost in a dead position. It cannot hunt for food. During that period of time, other eagles which have already gone through the molting process will bring food to feed these eagles in the molting season. This was the picture the Lord showed me concerning the arrival or the coming of the saints in glory to come and feed us and teach us when you are waiting on God. When you are soaking in God, but don't sleep. You can soak, but don't fall asleep. That becomes sleeping in the Lord. And this is the word of the Holy Spirit. The bride is being prepared for the coming of the bridegroom. The Lord Jesus is going to come, and He's coming for the bride. If He's coming for the bride must be made ready. Amen. You cannot afford to take vacation anymore. There's no time. You know, every waking moment that we have is just one day closer to the coming of the Lord Jesus. One day closer to the coming of the Antichrist. One day closer to the appearing or the proclamation of the false prophet. One day closer to the mark of the beast. One day closer for the end of everything. So if it is all one day closer to the end, every moment you live, you must make it tick for the glory of God. Amen?
Amen.
Let's stand up for a word of prayer. Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, thank You for making Yourselves known to us. Thank You for teaching us Your ways. Thank You for making Yourselves known to us.
And now I pray, Lord, all those who have heard this, prepare them to receive your glory. Even during these days, during this conference, I pray that you will prepare my dear sisters and brothers, and my dear children, and my sons and daughters. Prepare them, Lord, to meet with you. Prepare them to receive all that you have reserved to be released during this conference. I thank you, Lord, even as you have shown me in the past with regard to this church, Shekinah Worship. Pastor Joseph Sweet, you may remember years ago when I mentioned seeing scrolls being put into the walls of this church. One more time I see, just like Joseph had prepared barns to store wheat for the times of tribulation, I see the walls of this church filled with the scrolls of God. They appear not as walls but barns full of food, full of treasures for these last days. And you have been chosen, my dear brother, as a custodian, just like how Joseph was prepared in secret and in obscurity, down in a dungeon, forgotten, forsaken, but known unto the Lord. You have been prepared likewise for such a time as this. You will walk in the same anointing as Joseph walked. For you shall be lifted up as a prince to command the forces of God, even to channel and direct the armies of God, especially for this nation. So prepare yourselves, prepare your heart, keep it steadfast, locked on, looking straight ahead at your destiny and the purpose that God has determined for you. For I see you holding in your right hand the baton that was given to you years ago. And in the days to come, that baton will speak to you. It will open its mouth and speak to you concerning the oracles that are contained in it, the scrolls, the words of God that are contained in it, and the mysteries of God that are contained in it, and the destiny and the purpose. It will open its mouth and will speak to you. Not only it will speak to you, when it speaks to you, it will cause your eyes to be enlightened, to see the things that are spoken to you from the baton. Just like how, when the seals were broken one by one, the living creatures called out to John and said, "Come and see," instead of saying, "Come and read," the creature said, "Come and see." When John came and saw the scroll, it was not just letters, but it was moving pictures.
In the same manner, thank you, wonderful God. The baton is now hidden in your right hand, but it will come out of your right hand and then speak to you. Prepare your heart, and your dear wife also has a part in this. Prepare her, for together you are one, and both of you are one, having this destiny. Thank you, wonderful Lord Jesus. Come on, everybody, lift up your holy hands and bless the name of the living God, who is good, and his goodness is forever and ever. His mercies are from everlasting to everlasting. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new.